How's it going, guys? This podcast is brought to you by Rise Workout. Rise helps busy people manage their health, stress, fitness, and lifestyle through strength training. We understand that life's responsibilities can be time-consuming and still very important, like building your business or progressing your career or being present in your relationships and with your family. And sometimes our health can take the back seat and be neglected. That's why Rise gives you the programs to ultimately self-manage your own health and fast-track your results, because we know that the quality of your health will be a direct reflection of the quality of your performance and those other life responsibilities. Rise offers one-on-one personal training as well as group workshops to small to medium teams. Check us out at www.rise-workout.com. Now back to the podcast.
That's a vibe. She wanna vibe. That's a vibe. Yeah.
How's it going, guys? Welcome back to the High Frequency Club podcast. My name is Marlon Solerio.
And I'm Shanae Behrman. We are here discussing personal development, growth, and mindset.
Today's episode, we feature our friend, colleague, group fit instructor, and personal trainer out in the West, Consie Hookway.
Yeah, awesome chat with Consie today. We touch on how she finds balance in her very busy life and routine. She touches on revenge bedtime procrastination, which was quite an interesting topic, and how she's managed to deal with that.
Yeah, and I think it's so relatable and refreshing to hear from someone who has walked the walk of, you know, hustle, do. And she really shares her story on how she's finding balance, you know. I love her vulnerability that she shows, that, you know, it's not, she's not always perfect at it, but she's definitely further than what she used to be. And I know a lot of people can relate to this, you know, especially in this era of hustle and grind. Put no sleep on a pedestal, work your ass off. And how she's actually found she's been more productive and happier
since having better balance in her life.
And she shares her routines and how she's been able to detach from that type of mindset. I just love the overall vulnerability that she shows here. So I know our viewers, her clients, members, anyone that knows Consie is going to really benefit from this.
Yeah, definitely. Have a listen, let us know your thoughts at the High Frequency Club. Give us a comment, a like, a DM. We'd love to hear from you all.
Enjoy the show. Peace. Well, I'm excited for today because you've been an OG. I've known you for quite a while.
I know.
Since I started Liz Mills, you're already there. And for me, especially when we started, and then when I started instructing, you're always an instructor that I looked up to. Every time you posted, I was like, cool. It surprised me that you said you didn't do sprint anymore. Because I remember whenever you would post about sprint, I was like, oh yeah, that's a great cue. I got the stomp on the power sit from Consie. I got that from you. And I was like, fuck, that is such a good cue.
Yeah.
I always use it.
Yeah.
And it's been like 2 years.
Changing
up his cues if it's been 2 years of saying the same thing. Come on, man.
So like, how many instructors are saying stop?
But yeah, I'm super grateful that you're here, Cons. For the people that don't know you, did you want to introduce yourself, where you're from, who you are, and
So I'm Consie. I am a personal trainer at Les Mills New Lynn, GFI at Les Mills New Lynn, and then also work at a physio. So doing their front desk, which is like maybe 3.5 months old. So got it in between the lockdowns because, like, as you guys know, it's not like the best time to be a sole contractor. Just got that extra bit of income. But that's pretty much me. As you said, I've been at Britomart for like 5 years before I left. Yeah, so OG in the cement. Well, I'm not really, but I always love coming back to Britomart. So Britomart at heart, because I started there. Super cool there.
And is that how long you've been in the fitness game? Roughly 5 years.
I think I'm probably coming up. Well, I've worked at Les Mills coming up 6 years, but I started off on the front desk, and then about 2 years into that, I started GFI, and then I did that for about 2 years, and then I got my personal training qualification, so not ages. I'd still consider myself like a massive baby in the industry. Yeah.
Cool.
And
what sparked you getting into, I guess, fitness and wanting to be a PT and GFI?
I thought about this for ages, and it's sort of like there's a whole bunch of different things that branch into why I do what I do. But like the very first thing was So my very first loads and meals experience was body pump up at Auckland City. My sister took me, and it was Susan Renata, Emma Berry, and Charlotte. I can't remember her last name. And my sister was like, oh, do you want to come to a fitness class? I was like, yeah, yeah, all good. Like, sounds fun. Me, like, you know, goes for like a 30-minute walk every day. I'll be like, yeah, I'll be mean at it. And I remember the chest track, I had like only the bar or like ones, and there were like tears streaming down my face. I was like, what the fuck is this shit? Like, yeah. And then I couldn't move for like, oh, 2 weeks after that. But I enjoy the music, so yeah. Why do we love being in pain? So I liked the music. So that was the first time I'd been introduced to like exercise with music, because it was quite musical growing up. And so from then I went to a body combat class down at Britomart with Lana. And then again, I like couldn't lift my arms up like above here for like 3 weeks. and then, sometimes. And then I ended up buying a membership off one of my sister's friends, and then just like I was that person who only did the classes and probably like way too many classes. I was having a chat with someone the other day. I was like, oh my gosh, like I wonder what we actually looked like back in the day, like doing our first like squat track. Like it would be so cool to see a video of that. And then my sister actually suggested to me, she was like, well, why don't you teach the classes? And I was like, oh, I could do that. And so like 2 years later I did my first module. But I love being in a position where my skill or my product is benefiting other people. Like I fucking love that. Like it's so cool. Like I've always worked in an industry where I'm giving to other people. So I think that's the natural progression of why group fit worked. And then personal training as well. So that falls into the I love to be able to give my skill to people, but also I love showing people how capable they are. So I train specifically for capability and strength. So I love seeing clients get stronger. And that stems from my older brother. So he is autistic, and so physically way less able than most of people. So I just love like getting to know somebody and then being like, you've got your able body, you're capable, and just teaching them that frame of mind so they can see actually how much they can achieve. So that's something that I hold real close in all my sessions is like, you got a body, fucking use it.
I love that. I love that you just dive real deep on what got you started. Because normally with personal trainers, I say, no, the best market for you is where you've normally come from, so you can start telling people about it. And that's the best way to teach people, because you've been there, done that. Now you're just contributing back to them. And that's such a great story about your brother. So what's that process like? You know, what type of mindset do your clients come into your personal training sessions in? And, you know, where do you work from and where do you want to take them?
Yeah, for sure. Man, I've got a mixed bag for my clients. Yeah. I've got some people who it was literally their first time, like, touching a barbell. I've got people who've been fit for ages. I train a lot of instructors. So that's sort of like a niche that I've picked up as I train heaps of instructors. So I'm really, really lucky that the clients that I have are just, they've got the best attitudes. Like they listen and they're willing to listen. There's nothing more challenging than when you've got clients who sort of have this own idea in their head and you're trying to negotiate your way around it, because you don't want us to be like all high and mighty and be like, oh, like, you know, but I know this and I studied this and I've got the knowledge, because you don't want to belittle them, but it's kind of like bringing them around sort of to kind of come to your side a little bit. I did actually have one sort of case like that recently where this client just, he wanted to lift heavy like straight away. So we actually had a session where, and like being totally safe, I let him sort of experience it and be like, it's not there yet. It didn't work, this is why. And now he's over the other side of the bridge, and like, you know, we do light weights and good reps, like good technique. And it's just kind of, I think because I'm really great with people, I can kind of mold them into the particular mindset that I work with best, which is like someone who's willing to listen, someone who's willing to challenge themselves.
Big vibe about just allowing your clients to fail.
It's sort of like, it's like, oh, it's the nice.
It's a co-collaborative process I find personal training with client. You know, they come with something and you come with something and you come into the middle and create something together.
Yeah, yeah.
Like yesterday, a client came in and she was like, oh, my energy is like a 4 out of 10. And I was like, okay, cool. What do you think you best need right now? She goes, no, I want to do our squat test. I was like, okay, let's do it.
Yeah.
My targets was like, our targets is 55-60. Hmm. But I didn't tell her that. And I was like, there's probably a chance that you're not going to do it. So but I didn't tell her that as well. And we got to the fourth set and she struggled on 45 for 5. Where normally she could crack that for 10. Hmm. And then she sat down, she felt sad. And she goes, I feel like I'm a failure. And I was like, well, you had to fail.
Yeah.
Otherwise,
yeah, yeah.
If I told you that you couldn't do it, I would have set you up for failure. Mm. In a way, where I would have put my beliefs on you. But you've got to believe. So now she knows that, like, I've got to come in well rested. I've got to come in, you know, the preparation beforehand.
I had something so similar. I had a client yesterday, and so we're working towards like a real big deadlift for her. And she came to my class last night, and then she was like, oh, like I really, really, really want to try deadlifts tomorrow, but I'm not sure how it's going to go. And so she came this morning, and we didn't do deadlifts because she was like, nah, no way. And I think, you know, once people realize that your results or your training or your success is going to fluctuate, like it's going to go up and it's going to go 100%. Down. If you were peaking in all of your sessions, that shit would become so boring so fast. Mm. Like you've got to embrace that one day is going to be real good and then 3 days might be not so good. It's like that Instagram thing where it's like success isn't a straight line.
And that's so important for them to realize too, but they only realize that through experience going through it. And then I guess it's our job as instructors and personal trainers to encourage them to pick them up when they fall down. Just going back to what you said, that you know you've got your little niche of PTing instructors. Yeah. That's so interesting. That's so cool. What's a common theme that instructors come to you for that need your help on?
So I think for most of them, and this is me as well, like, just smash the mic. Tell me you're a GFI. is escapism from, because when you're teaching a class, and you guys will both get this, is you're on, you're not thinking about your own training. You're thinking about coaching, you're thinking about saying this, and then you're thinking about silence, and then breathing, and then moving, and all that sort of stuff. So for them, it's escapism out of their teaching mindset. And also fitness. So for classes, you gotta be so fit, man. You gotta be moving. You gotta be talking. So I think for them, they were just like, we want to do fitness. But for some of them, all they knew was classes, and that's fine. I'm like, great, cool. Come to me. Strength and conditioning outside the class. Put it into the classroom and all that sort of stuff. Yeah.
Ah, that's awesome.
And teaching them range.
Yeah.
They'll squat and they'll go like butts and knees. Yeah. I'm like, no, down.
Yeah. How do you find your own escapism? Because you're an instructor as well and personal trainer, and I'm sure that you can relate. The narrative is always in your head while you are teaching. And I find that so relatable, why instructors, even as a personal trainer, when I got my personal trainer, I was like, thank God I don't have to think. I just get
taught. Who did you train with?
I was with Ali.
Yes.
So I was like, yeah, I don't have to think about anything. My programs are done for me. I just do the best I can.
And it gives you more chance, as that's it, to think of yourself versus when you're teaching and you're focusing on everybody else. You're not really thinking about what you're doing. I think when you have a PT, you can just actually focus on yourself for once and how the movement feels for you and what you need to be
working on. It's actually self-care time.
Yeah.
What's your self-care time? What's your me time?
My me time? I am real specific. So I do a couple of things. I train, I've got a PT. And we're almost more friends than we are like trainer client. Like he's up at the city and he gets me, and it's almost like he can read instantly as soon as I walk in what we're doing. So that's I've actually got him today. So that's one of the things I do. Another thing I do, and you guys have both said this, is me time.
Yeah.
Oh my gosh, I need my me time. Like when you're giving so much energy throughout the day, I just like go home. And it doesn't need to be anything specific, but I just need quiet. Like quite often I won't have anything on, like I won't have a TV on, I won't have music on. I really enjoy being in quiet. And then the other thing I do is walking. Doesn't need to be inside or outside, it just like needs to be walking. And I'll listen to Broadway musicals.
Interesting.
Yeah. I'll have like my massive beats on. I'll be like walking and like
power walking.
Power walking, and in my head it's like Hakuna Matata. Yeah, so super, super particular taste with that. Or podcasts. Or I listen to a podcast.
Yeah.
Yeah, musicals and podcasts.
Cool.
That's what's up.
That's so cool.
And do you have a morning routine or a, like this one has about a 2 hour morning routine before
yeah, same.
Gets
yeah.
up seen on the ground. Yeah. But yeah, are you a morning routine or more of a night
routine? I'm a real shit person by like 3 o'clock onwards. So yeah. I'm like morning for sure. So Monday mornings teach. Tuesday mornings I've just started a new thing where I'll go to the pools mm-hmm. and swim. I was a swimmer when I was way younger, so that's actually something I've really, really been enjoying.
Yeah.
I've entered a midwinter swim in the ocean.
Cool.
Yeah, I don't know if it's that.
It will be cool.
Yeah, it will be cool.
Real cool.
Very cool. Yeah. It's midwinter. It's like literally called the iceberg, and I was like, oh yeah, okay. And then I entered it, and then I looked at how much wetsuits were. I was like, oh shit. They're like $500.
What made you want to do it?
Insanity. I don't know. No. it's something different, and I've not done something that's put me out of my comfort zone in ages. But I'm a good swimmer, like I'm a real, real good swimmer, so I know that whilst it'll be challenging, I'll be quite good at it
the
as well.
But you have
the
foundation to be there. As long as I've known you, you've definitely been the person that pushes themselves out of the comfort zone. You are cool. If you haven't pushed yourself outside of your comfort zone, like you said recently, what have you been focusing on in the interim?
Me?
Yeah.
Sleep.
Nice.
Yeah. I got this thing like 2 weeks ago, and it gives me like a sleep report at the start of each day. And it was so interesting because it'll break down the types of sleep that I'm in, and I mean, like, I don't know if it's 100% accurate or whatever, and I was getting like 6 hour sleeps, and like the quality was real bad. I was only in like deep sleep for like 45 minutes, and so like literally just the past week I'll try to get to bed as early as I can, but it's not the getting to bed, it's I'm up at like 5 a.m. every day, so it's the early starts that are causing the issue. And Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday I don't finish work till 8. So then like getting home, then like kind of getting into bed, but even the difference in the past 2 weeks, like if I get 7.5 hours sleep, I have a real good day.
Fuck yeah.
Yeah.
7.5 for me, 8 hours.
Yeah.
What's your routine? Because there's a lot of people that struggle with sleep, and a lot of people have made it normal to feel tired.
Yeah, don't prioritize
like 6-5 hours, you know?
Some people are like, yeah, I only got 3 hours sleep last night. I'm like, are you bragging?
Like,
that sounds horrible.
What's your night routine that's been helping you the past couple of weeks? What's
worked for you, like,
what doesn't?
All the typical. So I was actually reading about this the other day. It's revenge bedtime procrastination. So it's when you find yourself like the end of the day when you've actually got nothing to do, but if you haven't felt productive during the day, you try to make yourself feel productive by doing things at the end of the day. And that can be like watching TV or like cleaning or like doing this or doing that. So you're trying to make up for the hours of productivity that you didn't feel throughout the day at nighttime.
Yeah.
So I was reading up about that and I was like, oh my gosh, this is me. Like, they wrote this article about me. Like, so I would like clean the bathroom, I would vacuum my room, I would like rearrange my wardrobe like really, really late at night. So I've like cut out all that stuff. Yeah. I was like, you're weird.
No, I'm like, bro, I do that sometimes. Yeah. I've never known that that's an actual thing.
Oh, yeah. It's super fascinating. But yeah, so now I've done all the like stop looking at blue light, get off your phone, like put it in a like a different unreachable part of your bedroom and all that sort of stuff. I will like say goodnight to my flatmates at like 8.
Yeah.
And just go up to bed and again just be in the quiet. And just like I like now because I've experienced how good I feel on 7.5 hours sleep, I know that it's just not worth it. It's not worth it. There's nothing interesting on Instagram right now, or there's like no person who you have to talk to right now. So I just go into like a little cave.
Because because I've definitely gone through that before, and I'm like, fuck, I've done so many clients, now it's time to work on the other things.
Yeah.
And sometimes like I've got to be asleep by 8:30, and then I try finish work at like 8:15. But come on, like you need like an hour, right? Sleep is like going to sleep is like an airplane descending. It takes time.
I'm so bad at falling asleep. There are some people whose like heads hit the pillow and they're out. I'm like, what's that like?
That's not me either. What do you call it? Revenge
bedtime procrastination.
Revenge bedtime. Yeah.
It's those three words in some form.
Yeah.
Order.
So it sounds like to me when someone gets home, they feel like they weren't productive, even though they probably were. Like, I'm sure you're a productive person when you're awake.
I hope so.
So like It sounds just like a mindset thing when you get to that time and think that you have to do more. What did you have to change your mindset as well as the practical steps that you were productive or?
I just got tired. I was just getting so tired, and there's nothing worse than when your job is literally to give your energy to other people. And I teach late classes, like I've got one class that's at 6:30, and it's just you. I don't know. I mean, it might be different, but I personally just feel real shit when I know that I'm not giving as much as I've given before. Yeah. I've had that before as well, like years ago when I was working on reception at Bryn Mawr, and I was on the open, so 5:30 to 1:30 Monday to Friday, and then I would, back when I believed in fasted cardio, so I'd get to work at 4:30, do like 45 minutes, work 5:30 to 1:30, and then I'd train for like an hour, go home, sleep, come back and teach a class. Mm. And I did that for like 3 months. And then one day I woke up and I just, like, I couldn't move. I think all of that had just finally hit me. And I took a week off. Like I took a whole week off. And because I've experienced that like utter fatigue where you're just like, you're a body, but there's nothing left in you to do anything. Like that was my taste of it. I've been there. And now everything I'm doing now is to prevent that from happening again. Mm. Like I know I would never take it to that extreme because there is so much exercise. So I think because I've lived it and it's horrible. Like you're at home for a week and you're literally sleeping just to get back to where you were. Because you had shit patterns and you thought that all of this, what you're doing, was real cool and like people were looking up to you. No one cares. Mm. No one's like seeing you there at 4:30. Mm. Like no one's watching your like Snapchat story like, look, I'm on the stepper. Like, you know, no one cares about that. So
it sounds like when you touched on before fasted cardio, are there obviously a few things that you've like changed your mind on over your
I was having this chat with my client this morning and I was like, you know, the fitness industry, it's amazing, but it can also be so frustrating because like you can never be right and you can never be wrong. Like there's so much information being thrown at you all the time. And it's like, oh, but hang on, like I was doing that last week, but now this week it's, you know, it's the wrong thing to do. So I've done the broccoli, chicken, rice. I've done the fasted cardio. I've done the like heaps of water. I've done the coffees. I've done the teas and all that sort of stuff. So yeah, I've believed all the fitness myths. But I think the thing that I go with the most now is everybody's going to have something that works the best for them. And you just, you need to invest time in finding out what it is.
Mm, agree.
And I was called out like a couple months back. Like I dropped this comment about something on an Instagram post and the person who posted it like immediately called me out. And I was like, well, whatever, like this is my opinion. Like, you know, this is me, this is right. And anyway, it like sparked this whole conversation about all of this stuff and how difficult the fitness industry can be to negotiate. So that was like a big learning curve, I guess. And like since then, I've become much more open-minded. Like I can be quite a stubborn person. Like if I'm told I'm wrong, I'm like, yeah, okay, bye. Like, but like you do, you have to be open-minded and you have to like take in little bits of knowledge from each avenue and kind of mold it into your own like plate of things that works.
Yeah. And I think like you've said, how you may have changed your mind on those things, but you may still see people, either sometimes clients or other members, still doing that. Understanding that I guess everyone's on their own journey and they might not yet have, like you said, they might be trying that and at the time they do think this is working for them and fasted cardio is what they need to be doing. And like you said, it might just be with time that they come to the point where they're like, actually, I don't need to be doing this, or there's something else I could be doing. Or so yeah, I think you just have to be compassionate that everyone is on their own journey.
Yeah, and like you just kind of have to let some things slide and trust that, you know, you can't win over everybody. You can't help everybody, but I've got this like amazing little community of clients, and some of them, like I never tell them what to do or how to train. I just sort of like gently suggest it. And because I trust so much in the process of like basic moves, goals that are consistent, like I'm so much about consistency. Like that is just king over everything. And because I trust it and I just like gently push it into their routines, like have these types of conversations that, like I said, you know, they come around and they start to see the results. Like fitness doesn't need to be complicated. Like it's become so complicated, and like you see all these like fandangled moves over here and then like these fitness trends and then this and that, and it's just like, stick with the fucking basics.
Do the basics, like, and do them consistently.
But it's like if you like take a kid into like you know, like they've had this one like Pikachu soft toy their whole life, you know, and then you take them into a toy store and they see all these like cool new gadgets that are like available. It's really hard to bring them back
to their Pikachu.
To their Pikachu. Like that Pikachu's gonna be there all day, man. Yeah. You know, like so it's you gotta like bring back to the basics.
I agree. I think stick to the basics. That is basic. And I think the hard and complicated part is the consistency, actually the mindsets that surround actually doing the basics. I love how you touched on, you know, that fitness is, you know, it's been put on this pedestal of like do more, hustle grind, and I've been in that path, so Shanae, and you have as just mentioned.
Absolutely.
What would your advice be to those people, you know, who do use exhaustion as a metric of success, who do more but actually need to do less?
Stop. No. Stop. So, advice to someone who finds success through exhaustion. If it were a client, I guess that's a better position to be in because you can kind of, you can control the situations. Not sounding like a dick, but I feel like with the people who aren't willing to listen, you kind of just have to let, like, watch them, let them experience it themselves. Like, no one can keep up that form of intensity without having backlash somewhere, whether it be through injury, whether it be through fatigue, whether it be through their schedule becoming so unmanageable because they're so fit, their workouts need to become longer and they're sacrificing other parts of their life. Like, it will come full circle. Like, you can't exhaust yourself and expect to live a life that's healthy or, like, a life of quality.
Yeah, you've got that time must be taken out of somewhere, right?
Yeah, yeah.
And most of our clients, or actually all of my clients, they're not athletes. They don't have to be in the gym all day, every single day for 4 hours, you know? So if they're taking a lot of time out to do a lot of training, it's going to take time out of their work, their social life. And then for me as a personal trainer, as long as I can shine light on the other things that they actually really do prioritize after outside of training, then they realize, oh, fuck, I actually need to spend time with my mom and dad.
Yeah.
And, well, how are you going to do that? Oh, maybe it's don't go to a grit.
Because
you need it. Or, fuck, I've only got 5 hours sleep. Well, where are you going to get that time from?
Yeah.
I might not do body combat
at 7 p.m.
It's just seeing that worldly view, that outside view, outside of training.
Yeah.
Because I think a lot of people, including myself, when I was like overtraining, especially in the bodybuilding era, I just thought,
oh, that's right. Show me some photos. he will.
It turns into, it's an addiction. Like for me, it was like I was just running away from Fat Marwin. I didn't want to be Fat Marwin anymore. So I was like, okay, got to train 7 days a week. Got to do fasted cardio at 4 a.m.
How fun was that?
Not fun at all. And then like literally that first hour of my day on that fasted cardio treadmill would be me on my fitness pal, you know? Once I realized, I was like, well, I'm not running away. I'm not Fat Mahon anymore. You know, I'm not that person. Yeah. Once I realized that I didn't have to run away from my past anymore. You know, I gave myself permission to just enjoy what I have.
Yeah. You know? Yeah. I think you've got to find that balance with, you've got value in fitness. Like, well, we love training. Like, it's amazing. It's a great feeling. But you got to find value in the other aspects of your life. Like, no one's going to look back in 10 years and be like, oh, man, Shanae was so good at fasted cardio. They're going to be like, Shanae was awesome. She trained at the gym. She worked as a physio. She hung out with us. Like, it's so much about balance. And, like, I still see people in the gym. Like, literally, we were talking as we were walking up here. Like, you know, for some people, they're there, like, 4 hours a day. And you just... It just cuts me, but I'm like, but there's so, like, I love the gym, but there is so much more outside of these four walls. And, like, I think once you click, then that's going to be, like, a real special moment for some people. And some people might take ages to get there, you know, or they might not, but it's just, to anyone listening, there's definitely more outside the four walls of the gym.
What did you start to use to help you detach from, you know, the gym? Because you were there for a long time, too. In terms of all day, every day.
Yeah.
Like, I remember I was there.
No, it wasn't. That was you. God, you were there as well.
Did you have to start? Yeah, I was there. That's how I know. Yeah. What did you use to, you know, help you detach? What other passions did you find that you enjoyed?
So for me, it's only happened recently. So I think the first lockdown, because it's weird that we use lockdowns as like timestamps now.
Yeah.
But it's good. It helps me.
I
just remember so much, and I was like, then it was the second lockdown and this happened.
So it was pre the first lockdown. I moved from Britomart out to a full-time job at Takapuna, and I sort of started, I fell back into the same habit. So I'd go there real early, do my training, work my shift, go and then teach like three classes in the afternoon. And then I actually met one of my really, really good friends. She was working a job at a different Les Mills. And not that I didn't have any friends, but I met all these new people. And I was almost like, shit, what have you been doing for the past 3 years? Like training at the gym and closing yourself off from all these social opportunities because you're so tired. So I'd say in a sense she was actually not like a saving grace, but sort of like a saving grace. Like I got introduced to all these new people and we were going out and I sat at night and I was like, but what about 410 body pump? Okay. That sort of stuff. So I think refreshing myself of what it was like to have a social life and all that sort of stuff. And then when we hit lockdown and that contact was taken away from being able to go see family and stuff, I was like, shit, I need to invest more time in going and seeing my mum and my dad and my brother. So that happened now, and now I try to see them like at least once a week. Like my dad and I, we're going to start these little coffee dates Friday at his gym. And they actually know his name at the gym. I always give him shit that he never goes to the gym. They're like, hey, Trevor. I was like, oh, shit, he actually goes. And then my mum, she's actually coming to my other work at the moment. So just that, like investing time in that, and that's cool. Like some people don't get to see their parents. Like my sister's in London, so she hasn't seen us for, oh my gosh, I don't know how long. So yeah, I think it was just kind of being reintroduced to these things that were never not there, but I just didn't prioritize them because I was like, yeah, gym.
Yeah.
And then I'll like say this with hesitation, but So the job out at Takapuna was disestablished after the first lockdown. And when that first happened, I was like, fuck, like that really, really sucks. But looking back now, probably a blessing in disguise because I'm loving training out at Newland. Like the vibe out there just gels so much more with me. Like, oh, it's so cool. It's just like West Auckland, like to a T.
Yeah.
And then minimizing on classes. So pre first lockdown, I was teaching across 5 clubs, like 9 or 10 classes, so much petrol, so much like toing and froing. Like you say, you're rushing to these classes and you're feeling bitter because you're like, oh, I just sit in like 40 minutes of traffic. But yeah, so I think now only teaching out there as well, it's just life has just kind of all balanced out real well.
So
and also
awesome.
Learning.
So awesome to hear.
Yeah. And also learning, like, there's still this stigma around like you time is selfish time. And I think once you can kind of overcome that and realize that you time is probably the most valuable time you can put into your day, then you're away. Like, you're totally fine.
How good.
Yeah.
How good.
So good.
Heart
you got the nicest smile. Like a little cartoon bird just like floats through the room.
That's so awesome.
I think that would be, like, that's awesome that you were able to, like you said, that friend that kind of got you socializing more and you were able to see things outside of the gym. But it would be, I get why it would be so hard for people because you are a product of your environment. So if you are at the gym 24/7, everyone else that is at the gym is doing the same thing kind of thing. So you do almost get caught up in that mindset of like, well, everyone else, like,
oh,
she's
here
in the morning and at night. So you kind of just,
especially with classes, because you build such great friendship with the community Les Mills classes.
You know,
it's like, instead of going out for coffee, let's go to a class.
You
know, that's how they hang out.
So that's tricky, hard.
Like, you can see how people get caught up in just living at the gym morning and night and not thinking anything of it because they're seeing same people doing the same thing. I think it's, like you said, it's realizing when you're probably missing out on other stuff.
And I mean, like I said all that, but you know, I'm not saying that I've like topped life and I'm the master. Like, I'm sure there are going to be like many more road bumps to come, but it's taken me ages. That's like what, like 5 or 6 years to sort of like remember that, you know, like we can go out and have coffee, and it doesn't need to be after a class. Like, we can just go and all that sort of stuff. And yeah, there were times where I was like almost there, but I was like, no, I'm just going to go back to the shelter of the gym. So like, if anyone is sort of experiencing that reliance on the gym, like, there's no pressure to like get out overnight, but just know that, like, you know, you can kind of like test the waters a little bit.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. The gym will always be there. Classes will always be there.
Oh, 100%. Yeah, we're not going anywhere.
Yeah.
GFIs till we die.
You're so right. It takes time to unlearn something that has become automatic and habitual, right?
Even I find I still peak in, like, before the first lockdown, I think, and it wasn't long after we did a podcast talking about overtraining, and I reflect back and I was like, well, that was me. I was doing like probably teaching 10 classes a week, getting to CrossFit 3 times a week, trying to run as well. Like, I was just trying to do so many things.
Yeah.
And I didn't see that as overtraining, because I was like, oh no, that's it's balanced, because I'm like, because my schedule was balanced out, but it was like balanced out doing like 3-4 things a day.
I'm like, CrossFit now.
And then it wasn't until we got into the lockdown and I just pretty much did nothing other than just like running and walking. And I was just sort of like, as if I was doing like so much all day, every day. And that's when I kind of realized, wow, I was doing too much, and then eased myself back into it. But then even at the moment, I found myself caught up with covering other people's classes to the point that I'm a bit covers. Like, Shanae, you're doing 3-4 classes a day. And that's when I'm like, well, need to. And again, it just takes me to getting to that point where I'm feeling fatigued. I'm constantly achy. I don't have the energy that I'm like, this is too much. You need to pull back again in order to have the energy that you need to deliver a good class and to enjoy yourself. Otherwise, if I'm sore when I'm rocking up for my third class a day, being like, woo, let's go. It's just not authentic and I'm not enjoying it. And that's why I do it, is because I enjoy it.
Because how many classes are you on a week?
Psych! And end of podcast. thanks, Consie.
Get out.
That's
not a number.
Yes.
I've just said yes to a couple more classes, for probably about 10 ish.
So, Marwan.
That I've said yes to these other ones, that's why I'm like, I need to cut, like, I'm going to have to drop a couple of other classes.
Yeah.
Because I know that, my enjoyment otherwise is not going to be there.
And
I'm not going to be, enthused or energetic to teach.
No, I was asking because, I'm on 3 classes, which is amazing, but I know that if I take on a certain amount of covers, if I go over, something's going to go wrong. If I do more than, three covers a week, I'm going to be sore, I'm going to be, missed out on my sleeping on a Sunday, hard boundaries, I can sleep in on a Sunday.
Mm. Yeah.
I'm just thinking, wait, who's going to call me out on this? So I think that's also like a little superpower in itself, is knowing yourself so well.
That you know where your limits are.
Yeah, you know where your limits are. You're like, oh, I'm tired, but I can still get through it. It's like, I'm tired, I need to take a step back.
I know if I'm at where I'm at now, I can't do covers. Whereas I prefer to have 6 classes, so that I can say yes to the odd cover here or there without it being an overload.
Mm.
And again, be able to do other training that I enjoy doing. Because the same previously, I was getting back into running, and then obviously running's stopped now because I'm like, where can I run when I'm at the gym?
Yeah.
So
I hear that story often, that instructors just overdo it with covers and stuff like that. What makes them want to take on so much knowing that they shouldn't?
It's probably a whole bunch of different reasons. Honestly, for me, if I take on extra covers, I'm like, cool, that's a financial thing. That's like a little bit more money on my next paycheck. Some classes I genuinely enjoy teaching. I can teach 7 programs, but I only teach 3 of them. So if a combat cover comes up or a trip cover comes up, I teach it because I know it's going to be fun. It's kind of like the novelty there. It's like, oh, I haven't taught this in ages. Let's just go have some fun, throw some punches.
Yeah.
And saying that I'm covering a 60-minute on Friday, and I'm like, I'm petrified.
You'll be back to not being able to lift your arms.
Personally for me, it's knowing that the paycheck will be a bit fluffier. And enjoying teaching classes. I can't really speak on behalf of other instructors, I guess, because outside my gym hours I'm busy. There are hours that are blocked out where it's I'm at my other job, I can't do it. Some people, they've got the time, and I know as well, we love to help out our GFMs. Our GFM out at Newland is just she's just this amazing person. You just want to help her, but there's also wanting to help and not putting yourself on the line and all that sort of stuff. This week's mental because it's filming week, so we have
heaps of covers.
I don't.
I think that's me. It's my inability to say no in that I feel like you got to do it for the team.
Yeah.
Like, if, and I usually will try and, if I know, like, I can't really take on any more covers, I'll wait until I've seen that no one else is free.
Oh, yeah,
everyone
yeah.
has said no.
Yeah.
And everyone's like, sorry, it works, sorry, it works, sorry, it works. And then I've been like, I'll do it.
Yeah.
Even though I don't want four Super classes Chanae. In a day, but I will do it for you. Like,
it's interesting though. Like, why do you think there is, I don't think fear is the right word, but it's like, why do people struggle to say no so much?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You know, it's really, really interesting because, like, you know, if you, is it because you know this person on a personal level? Like, because it's easy to say no to people who you don't know, but it's as instructors, it's like, no, I'm so sorry, I can't do it. Like, no, I'm so sorry. Oh, okay, I'll do it.
Yeah.
It's like, what's that barrier? Like, why do we struggle to say no so much?
That's a good question.
And apologize so much as well. I think we're always like, so sorry, but it's just sort of like, why do you, if you're at work, you're at work.
I'm working. Wait.
Am I sorry that I'm at work, or am I sorry that I've already got plans and therefore I can't commit?
But yeah, I've tried to stop apologizing, but it's like,
natural.
It's like as soon as you say I'm not going to say sorry, like, shit. Like,
Fuck, so much value in that. What's a couple more questions? What's on the future, on the horizon for Consie?
My ocean swim. I'm not nervous. You're nervous. Again, I was actually having this chat with my dad the other day because, like, we're in May. Mm. And I know we say this every year, but it's like, I honestly don't know where that time passed. And for me, as I'm sure with so many people, probably with you guys as well, this year has just been getting back into routine, like finding some stability through my habits. So having the work at the physio is great, and that's made my hours at the gym, and like I said, way more strict. It's like, my PT sessions are booked here. If you're not here, I can't see you till next week. Mm. And that's like, that's not being a dick. That's just the reality. Like, I'm real busy. Future Consie. I've got like a big goal at the end. So now I'll just be taking little steps to hopefully achieve that goal. I think I let the first couple months of this year live in like, oh, but what if we go into lockdown? Like, better not plan this, better not plan. And like, I think there have been so many people, but it's like I say to you, you know, you can't not book the tickets to go home because something might happen. Like, that's literally like living in fear. And I think, like, you know, we did enough of that last year. So yeah, I've got a plan. I've got a big goal, which I'll just quietly keep to myself until until that day comes. But yeah, I'm just enjoying how everything's working at the moment. And I think I deserve that. Like, I think once you've found the balance, it's all right to live in that for a bit and enjoy it, because it's not been a smooth road. And like I said, there'll be road bumps to come. So I'm just enjoying my day to day so much right now.
Awesome.
That's good.
So the last question, we love to leave our listeners with three practical, positive tips that they can go and take away and
better themselves.
You know, better themselves right here, right now. What are three tips that you would leave our viewers and listeners?
I thought about this for so long. So one thing that I still hear lots in the gym, so this is more of like a don't, but with some do's afterwards. So don't put so much value into aesthetic. You know, like, I think people are so focused on how they look or how they think about how others see them. And, you know, like, people want to train to like lose weight or like look like this, and you hear in classes like lunge to get lean legs and all that sort of stuff. And I think it's okay, but I think there's a way bigger picture on how to shape that. Like, instead of focusing on aesthetic, like, focus on performance goals, focus on how you feel, focus on habits you can create that are maintainable, that you can be really, really consistent with. So the don't would be like, don't put so much value in aesthetic, and put value in how you feel, put value in how your body moves, put value in the fact that you've got an able body, and, you know, work around that. Get a coach, invest in a coach, the right coach. Like, I think it's hard with trainers, you know, there is this area of trainers where, you know, we look like the people who are just counting to 10, we don't care. And I think, you know, when people hear personal trainer, they're like, oh, those are just the people who hang out at the gym to take my money. And it's like, there probably are trainers like that, and we can just like put them in this bracket. But I can guarantee that if you find a trainer, and even if you say to them, like, I just want to do like 3 sessions, 4 sessions to learn how to move around the gym. If that person is the right trainer for you, you will stick it out with them.
Mm.
You know, and I've had that with people. I've had both. So I've had people sign up, they've done the couple of sessions, we've set them off with the program, and then I've had people stay with me because we just clicked. Mm. You know, so I won't be the right coach for everybody, but there will be a coach out there for you, go find them.
Yeah.
Mm.
And then same with you won't be the right PT, you won't be the right GFI for everybody, but there will be someone. So invest your time in finding the perfect coach for you. Like I've been through PTs, mm. I've been through so many, but now like I've found my one, and the only reason I left my other one because they moved overseas.
Mm.
So yeah, find the right coach. You know, it's like you spend time finding the right GP, you spend time finding the right hairdresser. Personal training is no different. We're here to like set you up. These are the skills, and now let's do it together.
Mm.
It's a real, you know, and it, whilst it's a real cool job to be in, like tips for personal trainer, like be more responsible. You know, this person is putting so much trust in you. You can't just categorize them as, you know, this is client one, this is client two, this is client three. Like if you think you are training somebody who doesn't have self-confidence issues, you're wrong. If you think you're training somebody who doesn't have or hasn't had in the past like disordered relationships with eating and exercise, you're wrong. If you think you don't have clients who like sort of like diss themselves but then disguise it with humor, like you're wrong. You know, you've got to take responsibility. This person is putting so much trust in you, take that responsibility and just be a fucking good trainer. So that's the tip to trainers, is like there's a reason personal is ahead of trainer. Like it's a, you're not counting 1 to 10 or 10 to 20. I mean, we can't count anyway. So yeah. This morning I was like, yeah, 8 to go, and she was like, 7. sorry.
Awesome. Thank you so much for coming. There's so much fire shit in that episode.
Yeah.
So yeah.
Mikey Mike.
Oh, sweet. Mikey Mike. Thanks guys. Peace.
Sweet. That's a vibe. She wanna vibe. That's a vibe. Yeah. That's a vibe. It's a vibe.